Listening Library presents Firsts and Lasts, 16 stories from our world and beyond. Edited by Laura Silverman. Read for you by Shayna Small, Annie Q, Frankie Corzo, Vivi Nguyen, Elena Ray, Victoria Villarreal, Andre Santana, Tashi Thomas, Jamie K. Brown, and Emily Iden. To everyone who has a nostalgic heart and big feelings, Ellis. Content warnings for the following stories. The first time I dated a vampire. Grief related to familial death. The first time we buried a body. Death, violence, and attempted assault. The first time I saw the stars. Depression and self-harm. The last dinosaur. Grief related to familial death. The last purity ball. Sexual harassment. The last goodbye. Death and drug addiction. The last time I saw her alive. Death.
Firsts. The First Time I Dated a Vampire by Julian Winters. I'm certain of two things. I'm ready for this summer trip to end, and one more night in Santa Monica won't change that. Tyrell, we're here. I blink out of a daze. It happens a lot lately. Moments where I'm anywhere but the present. I jerk to face my mom, the seatbelt strap digging into my neck at the sudden movement. What? Through the windshield, ribbons of gold from fairy lights hung outside glow across mom's face. We look alike. Warm brown skin with reddish undertones. Smallish noses and long necks. But my curls, kept short with the sides of my head faded, aren't hers. Neither is my bow-shaped mouth or awkward limbs. Those are all dad. Are? Were? How do you describe something you inherited from a parent who's now dead? These days, I'd prefer not to discuss him. Mom hasn't gotten the message yet. She smiles wearily. Do you really want to spend your last night watching a movie? Yes. We've been here a month. You've barely seen the city. Only the walls of the house we're renting and... Mom gestures to the building across the street. Reagan Cinema is a movie theater with old-school vibes, red velvet upholstered bucket seats, a giant marquee lit up in neon green and red, big block letters advertising, Friday Night Classics presents Twilight. Is that really a classic? Mom whines. I'm so old. I don't comment. I'm surprised you haven't seen it yet, she continues. You're so obsessed with supernatural things. Your dad loved vampires, too. I don't want to see the city, I tell her, quickly avoiding the topic of dad. This is fine. Ty, she says, cupping my cheek. There's so much to experience here. She talks like she hasn't lived in Decatur, Georgia, where we're from, her whole life. As if this isn't the first time for both of us in Santa Monica, where my dad grew up. She's clinging to the brittle memories of who dad was. Ever since they lowered his body into the ground 182 days ago, I've been pretending none of this is happening. Rumor has it, Mom wiggles her eyebrows, there are tons of cute guys around your age. Maybe you can... Ugh. I scramble to unbuckle the seatbelt, strangling my flushed neck. No thanks, just the movie. Before I can leap out into oncoming traffic, Mom's coral pink nails, which match her sundress, dig into my forearm. She's truly embracing the California aesthetic. Me? Scuffed Vans, black joggers, and a Rick and Morty graphic tee. Fitting in feels pointless. No curfew tonight. Mom's lips gentle into a grin. Stay out after the movie. When I blink, she quickly corrects, within reason. You're 17. College is around the corner, and... She pauses, clearing her throat. Give yourself the chance to fall in love with this place. I ignore the urge to roll my eyes. Mom, do you have the list? The one she airdropped to my phone the second we landed. A checklist of all the city sites Dad wanted to show me. The three of us were supposed to be here together. Dad planned the trip early last year. Then he got sick, and... Well, I nod stiffly. Go do things, she insists. Maybe it'll feel like he's here with you. It won't, I want to tell her. Nothing does. Being in his hometown without him feels wrong. I don't want to give it a chance. Problem is, I don't want to go home either. Okay, I lie through the thickness in my throat. I'll text you when I'm ready. Her smile widens. I wonder if she knows I'll never be ready. Friday nights at Reagan's are like any other, a butter-scented ghost town. It's 3 blocks from 3rd Street Promenade, where there are 2 AMCs less than half a mile from each other. But Reagan's is my favorite spot to watch movies. I check my phone, 10 minutes before start time. I ignore the pain needling behind my ribs at no new messages from my best friend, Kellen. His last text was days ago. An LOL to a meme I sent, the extent of our communication now. It's another reason I don't want to go home. I'm not the Ty Kellen's known since middle school. While I'm at the snack bar, contemplating my options, a throat clears. I lift my eyes and, come on, universe. Why now? A boy in a black Reagan's t-shirt leans his elbows on the glass counter. His fair, tawny complexion drinks in the bright overhead lights. We're both scrawny, except he looks way more confident in his skin. Black fringe slices into his narrowed dark eyes. If thunderclouds could take human form, they'd be Sean Cam. His lips tilt up. Why am I not surprised to see you? I'm still deciding, I say through my teeth. You didn't answer my question. Because you should have asked, how can I help you? I snap, like a model employee. You get the same thing every Friday. What if I got Twizzlers? I try. And a Coke. More hair falls across his eyes. He scoops it away to say, flatly, are you? No. My nose wrinkles. Nachos, extra cheese. A wicked smirk pulls at his lips. He's waiting. And a small blue raspberry slush, I whisper. Now that we've established you're basic and predictable, he says, moving around the snack bar like there's air under his soles. Tell me you're not here for that movie. Here we go again. I heard it's good, I say. From who? I don't answer. Mom's right. Supernatural stories are my favorite. Dad's too. Secretly, we both believed in the unreal. That underneath this cruel and sometimes unexplainable world, things like monsters and myths must exist. Not that I've ever seen one. The whole thing's tragic. Sean plonks a box of nachos and a large cup of slush on the counter, startling me. I raise an eyebrow when he doesn't charge me for the bigger size. It's so corny, also inaccurate. It's a movie, I say while paying. Your point? His features are sharp, almost beautiful when he squints. Unexpected heat blooms under my cheeks. My point is, I say. Every Friday, you give me your hot film takes, even though I never ask. You hate everything, like the last Transformers movie. Everyone hated that shit show. True. I say, what about the remake of... Let me stop you right there, he interrupts. Remakes are inherently awful. The world deserves more original content. Right. Again. Fine. I lean on the counter, smiling. Name one Christopher Nolan movie you like. I can't. He's the devil. Sean replies without blinking. His longest rants are always about Nolan. But when did I start caring enough to save that information? Our faces hover inches apart. His eyes are obsidian pools trying to drown me. I quickly straighten. A group of noisy boys charges into the theater I'm supposed to be in. After a beat, I say, "Vampire movies are never bad." "Enjoy your suck fest," Sean calls after I gather my nachos and drink. My hands are too full to flip him off. I disappear into the cinema without another word. I sit on the curb outside Reagan's after the movie. It's barely 8 p.m. The sky's a hypnotic swirl of golds, oranges, and reds. Dipping sunlight glitters off nearby buildings. Santa Monica's nothing like home. Then again, home isn't a place I know anymore either. I hug my legs to my chest. It's too early to text Mom. She'll find a way for us to visit every destination on that list, forcing me to love a city I don't want to be in without Dad.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.